Everyone, good afternoon. Welcome to today's special session on advancing HIV, aging, and rehabilitation. Where does rehabilitation fit in the HIV care cascade? And this flows very nicely from the lunchtime session that we had today for those of you who were in this room just a few hours ago. So I'd just first like to begin by acknowledging that the land on which we gather today for this special session is the traditional and unceded territory of the Mohawk, a place which has long served as a site of meeting and exchange amongst nations. And I hope that we'll continue that exchange today. So I'm Kate Murzin. I'm the health program specialist at Realize, which is formerly the Canadian Working Group on HIV and Rehabilitation. And I'm pleased to be the moderator of today's session. I have no disclosures relevant to today's content. So today's session is proudly co-hosted by three organizations: CIHRRC, or the Canada International HIV and Rehabilitation Research Collaborative, Realize, my organization, and CAHR, the Canadian Association for HIV Research. And we have three overarching goals for today: to discuss the role and emerging evidence for rehab in the context of HIV across both the life course and the HIV care cascade, to facilitate knowledge transfer and exchange on HIV aging and rehabilitation research, and to explore examples of rehabilitation practice for people aging with HIV. So this is just a snapshot of what we hope to do during today's session. I'm going to start by providing an introduction to Realize and to CIHRRC, and then we're going to define what we mean for the purpose of this session about what rehabilitation is. And then I'm going to set the stage for our panel discussion by talking a little bit about how we integrate rehabilitation into the HIV care and treatment cascade. And after the panel session, we hope to have some time to engage with you around questions related to that integration. So a little bit about Realize. We're a national HIV organization here in Canada and a leader and catalyst for improved rehabilitation services for people living with HIV through research, education, policy, and practice. And our primary mandates at Realize are to coordinate and advise on issues of disability and rehabilitation in the context of HIV, to support and undertake initiatives in rehabilitation and HIV, and to encourage pan-disease collaboration to address issues that are experienced by people living with HIV and those with other complex episodic or chronic diseases. So our areas of focus include income security and labor force participation, mental health, access to rehabilitation services, and my area of expertise, which is HIV and aging. So this slide just shows some of the work that Realize and our partners on the National Coordinating Committee on HIV and Aging have been undertaking over the last 5 to 6 years. So you'll see here the National Coordinating Committee on HIV and Aging on the right-hand side of the slide in the policy quadrant. This is a group of stakeholders who come from research, from frontline service provision, they're clinicians, and most importantly, older adults living with HIV who share an interest in the topic of HIV and aging and who come together to brainstorm some of the emerging issues and some collective solutions to how we address some of those issues. We've been pushing solidly over the last few years for disaggregation of the epidemiological data for the 50 plus age group. So as many of you will be aware, prevalence data in Canada is not disaggregated by age at all. And incidence data is provided for 10-year age categories up to age 50 and is not disaggregated at all after that. And so it's very hard for us to know what programs and services are needed when we don't know how many people are 55, how many people are 70, and how many people are beyond that. And so that's something that we continue to push for. In the practice realm, we've been engaged in a project called Working Together. This is a project that brings together service providers from the HIV sector and from aging organizations like home care and long-term care, brings them together into one group and provides training on HIV and aging and how to provide care that's tailored for this age group. We've also conducted, in collaboration with Charles Furlot at McMaster University, an environmental scan of programs and services related to HIV and aging in Canada. If you haven't visited our booth already in the exhibit hall, we do have that report available there, and it's also available on our website, and I'll provide those coordinates in a minute. We've engaged in World AIDS Day social media campaigns regarding HIV and aging, just to try to bring visibility to the fact that not all people living with HIV are young, not all people vulnerable to HIV are 20. In fact, the largest growing number or proportion of new infections is actually in the 50 plus age group, and we need to start to recognize that that group has specific needs when it comes to both HIV vulnerability and support. And finally, we engage in research. So I'm working right now with Sergio Rueda at CAMH to do a study on successful aging in the context of HIV. And we're doing interviews here in Montreal. So if anyone is interested in taking part, you can connect with me. But we're also partners on a lot of rehabilitation research. So for example, we are a partner on the community-based exercise study that Kelly is going to talk to you some more about in a moment. So who is CAHR? So CAHR stands for the Canada International, it was formerly UK, but has expanded, HIV and Rehabilitation Research Collaborative. And CAHR is an international research collaborative that includes a diverse group of stakeholders who share an interest in HIV and rehabilitation research. And this collaborative came together through the recognition that this work was a niche that was not being explored, but there were some innovative programs and practices emerging in these settings that had some relevance to being considered for implementation and for furthering a collaborative approach to research across these countries that have similar social circumstances. So it's my job to preface today's talk with a little introduction to what is disability and what is rehabilitation, because that's sort of going to underpin everything we talk about today. So when we talk about disability at Realize, we use the ICF framework, which is the International Classification of Functioning, Disability, and Health. And the ICF is a biopsychosocial model of disability, which means it describes disability as being an outcome of the interaction between a health condition and contextual factors. So it identifies three levels of human functioning: functioning at the level of the body or the body part, whole person activity or whole person functioning, and how the person interacts with their social environment. And the model also recognizes that in addition to a health condition contributing to disability, the environment also contributes to the experience of disability through external factors such as stigma, legal and policy issues, and internal personal factors like aging, gender, and other things that impact how people experience disability. And disability basically involves dysfunction at one or more of these levels of human functioning. And so people living with HIV sometimes say, well, I've never considered HIV a disability before. But under this model, just to give some examples of the kinds of things that people living with HIV might experience, these are forms of disability according to the ICF framework. So someone may experience pain in their legs or feet from peripheral neuropathy. That would be an impairment at the level of the body. Someone may experience difficulty cleaning their apartment, for example, due to fatigue or other considerations like mobility, and that would be an issue at the activity level. And then someone may avoid dating as an HIV-positive person because of fears about disclosure in the context of criminalization, and that's a participation restriction. So the way we define rehabilitation at Rehab, and for the context or for this workshop today, is rehabilitation is any service or activity that addresses or prevents body impairments, activity limitations, and social participation restrictions experienced by an individual. So we're not thinking about rehab solely as formal professional rehab services like occupational therapy and physiotherapy. We're thinking broadly about any services or activities that can help improve quality of life and decrease disability for people living with HIV. I just realized I have to press this again. So my area is HIV and aging, and just I like to present the lived experience of someone living and aging with HIV as kind of an onion. So in the core of that onion are all of the questions that anyone who's aging may ask themselves as they grow older. What's my purpose? What am I going to do with my time? Who's going to be there to support me? Will I have the resources necessary to live the life I want to live into older age? But when we add HIV, we add another layer of complexity that is influenced by the presence of stigma, both HIV-related and aging-related, a history of multiple losses, concerns about appearance and desirability, especially for people affected by lipodystrophy, the impact of episodic illness on employment across the life course and how this impacts income security in older age, the fact that people aging with HIV are a relatively new aging population and may not be on the radar, their needs may not be on the radar of people working within the aging sector. And finally, we're going to hear from the panelists that HIV can sometimes mean that chronological age is not necessarily a measure or a good measure of function. And then, of course, you add another layer of complexity when you add other elements like race, gender, sexual orientation. And I won't say more about that. Probably people in the room are pretty clear on this. So in terms of disability experienced by people aging with HIV, I just wanted to give some high-level statistics, and our panelists are going to go into more detail on this. But about 25% of people living with HIV report difficulty with one or more activities of daily living. 18 to almost half of individuals report challenges with instrumental activities of daily living. And a quarter of older adults living with HIV report having fallen in the past year, which in the context of high rates of osteoporosis and bone disease can be especially risky. We also recognize that age is one of the factors that increases the risk of disability amongst people living with HIV, as is poorly controlled HIV, greater number of health conditions and comorbidities, which I think Dr. Julian Falutz is going to talk about in a moment, and having a lower nadir CD4 count. So at Realize, we like to take a strengths-based approach, and we talk about strategies for coping with disability. And this is some of the things that you're going to hear about today from the panelists. So we have self-management and daily living strategies, rehabilitation services, informal supports, and also formal supports and services like home care, household maintenance, meal delivery, and medical care and treatment. So the question is, how does this fit into the HIV care cascade? This slide from the Public Health Agency of Canada shows our progress towards meeting the 90-90-90 targets across Canada at the end of 2014. So sometimes we see the cascade appear with three steps, like this one, that correspond to those 90-90-90 targets. Other times, like earlier during today's lunchtime session, we see a cascade which gives us a little bit more information about engagement and retention in care, but essentially the cascade exists in whatever form it exists. And definitely it has policy implications. So the 90-90-90 targets are inherently based in a biomedical model. And questions that I want you to think about today during the panel are, should viral suppression be the ultimate goal that we're aiming for? That's a great goal in terms of HIV prevention and onward transmission of HIV, but is that really serving the interests of people who are already living with HIV that we consider the end point to be you're on treatment and virally suppressed? Don't get me wrong, having targets is a really good thing, but it's important to be critical about whose agenda they serve, who sets these targets, why were they chosen, and what are the implications that they have on funding. For example, if we're redirecting funding towards activities that address 90-90-90, What are we taking funding away from in the world of quality of life and support programs? So it's not all bad news. We do see in Ontario, for example, that the new HIV strategy does call for people living with HIV. The goal is to help them enjoy better health and quality of life, and we hope that they receive integrated care from interdisciplinary teams that address their physical, mental, and social health needs. But there is no mention of rehabilitation in that strategy, and there are no provincial standards for the type or the mix of service professionals that should be involved in HIV care. This is one of the other aspects that's deficient in the 90-90-90 goals, is we talk about engagement and retention in care, but primarily that's referring to your HIV specialist or the person who provides your HIV medication, not the suite of professional service providers and peers who could be supporting the development of healthy quality of life. So that brings us to the question of the panel. Where does rehabilitation fit within the HIV treatment cascade? And what does this mean for people who are aging with HIV? So I'm going to briefly introduce our first panelist, Dr. Kelly O'Brien from the Department of Physical Therapy at the University of Toronto. Welcome, Kelly.
Thanks very much, Kate. This is my conflict of interest disclosure slide here. And to place this context of disability and rehabilitation in the care cascade, I'm going to share with you some findings from a couple of research studies I've had the ability to be involved with, the first being something called the HIV Health and Rehabilitation Survey, or the HHRS for short. This was a cross-sectional web-based survey with 941 adults living with HIV in Canada, with the aim of describing the prevalence of disability, multi-morbidity, and rehabilitation services use among the community. Participants, respondents to this web-based survey, reported living with a median of three concurrent health conditions in addition to HIV, 72% of the sample of which were living with two or more conditions in addition to HIV. And when we compared adults who are younger versus adults 50 years of age and older, a larger proportion of adults 50 years of age and older in the sample were living with comorbidity. And the key highlights are here were mental health conditions defined as stress, anxiety, and depression, muscle and joint pain, high cholesterol, blood pressure, and triglycerides, neurocognitive decline, bone and joint disorders. And while at a lesser prevalence, there were some respondents who also reported living with frailty, which we know and relates to a lot of Julian Falutz's work, who will speak about some frailty probably later in the panel today, and poses a really big role, I think, for rehabilitation to play when it comes to HIV and aging. So as individuals are living with this level of multimorbidity, there's the possibility of individuals also living with increasing levels of health-related challenges, or as we define as disability, with HIV and this multimorbidity. And as part of the HHRS, we measured the presence and severity of disability using something called the HIV Disability Questionnaire, or HDQ for short. And the bubbles in this slide represent the six dimensions of disability, or domains of disability, that was established through some earlier qualitative work. The take-home message from this slide is that uncertainty was a really key component, and that was defined as uncertainty and worrying about the future health that may impact life decisions in the future, such as buying a house, returning to work, starting a new relationship, for example, and how that impacted one's overall health. The highest presence and severity scores in this self-reported disability questionnaire was in the uncertainty domain, followed by mental and emotional health challenges, as well as challenges to social inclusion. And this was for across different age groups. We then conducted a path analysis to look at how those relationships between those dimensions of disability played out. And again, uncertainty was a key driver of this model, which was a strong predictor of mental and emotional health, as well as challenges to social inclusion, even after adjusting for physical and cognitive health challenges. So the HHRS was a cross-sectional snapshot of disability at one point in time, but Patty Solomon has done some qualitative work looking at how that experience of disability may change over the period of time, involved in a qualitative study conducting interviews with 24 adults 50 years of age and older over the course of four times, 5 months apart for a total of 20 months. And they used a team-based approach to qualitative analysis, looking at between and within differences and comparisons over the course of time. And the team has identified four trajectories of potential experiences of how disability may remain stable over time, worsen over time, improve over time, as well as fluctuate, so get better or get worse over periods of time. And this relates to different aspects of disability, such as physical symptoms, such as fatigue and pain, memory problems related to cognition, mental and emotional challenges, such as stress and anxiety, as well as that uncertainty and worrying about the future. So individuals and the way in which those aspects of disability fluctuated over time was really related to this concept of these contextual factors that can interact with and exacerbate or alleviate those dimensions of disability over time. This slide demonstrates some of the themes that were established through earlier qualitative work related to this episodic disability framework that spoke about extrinsic or environmental factors such as social support and stigma that could exacerbate or alleviate disability, as well as intrinsic contextual factors. Now, the social support, I would say the second bubble in, support from accessing healthcare services and personnel, is where accessing traditional forms of rehabilitation services such as physio and OT would fall under. When the respondents to the HHRS survey, only 17% of respondents had seen a physiotherapist in the past year, 6% an occupational therapist, and 3% a speech-language pathologist. In the absence of accessing formalized rehabilitation services, respondents were accessing complementary and alternative therapy services and providers, as well as services provided at community-based and aid service organizations. In addition to this, individuals reported taking on something called living strategies, and this was a term coined by some earlier qualitative work, defined as any attitudes, behaviors, or beliefs that individuals may utilize in order to deal with the day-to-day challenges living with HIV. And these include seeking social interaction with others, maintaining a sense of control over one's life, trying to block living with HIV and challenges out of the mind, and adopting positive attitudes and beliefs. So these may be, were considered as potential modifiable factors that could influence those exacerbations and alleviations of disability over time. Respondents in the HHRS survey adopted many of these living strategies, such as 92% of the sample, most or all of the time adhering to their medications, 65% maintaining a healthy eating regimen, and among many others, we looked at some of the potential differences across different age groups, and compared to younger adults, less than 49 years of age, a higher proportion of adults 50 years of age and older engaged in some forms of living strategies, such as eating well, maintaining good sleep hygiene, adopting positive attitudes and beliefs, as well as prioritizing, anticipating the future and planning for the future as well. 37% of the respondents also reported that they engaged in some form of exercise most or all of the time, and there were no differences across the age group. So it kind of poses the question, me being a physiotherapist, what role might exercise play? I've had the opportunity to be involved with Stephanie Nixon in a Cochrane Collaboration systematic review. We recently completed an update of this review that involved 24 randomized control trials comparing exercise to no exercise with just over 1,200 participants. And when we conducted the meta-analyses, there were no differences in change in viral loads and CD4 count largely across the comparisons. So when we're thinking about viral suppression as being an aspect of the 90-90-90, however, there were significant improvements found in cardiopulmonary fitness, strength, weight and body composition, and quality of life outcomes as well. And so that aspect led me to think about sort of what are the outcomes that we should be considering. And Richard Harding spoke yesterday about work that he's been doing called the Positive Outcomes Study in developing a patient-reported outcome measure for people living with HIV in the UK. And he's identified some key dimensions to consider in developing this patient-reported outcome measure based on 30 qualitative interviews with people living with HIV as well as providers of care. And these key dimensions or constructs include physical and cognitive health, psychosocial outcomes, information about HIV health and medications, and including a global overall assessment, how are you doing generally, and the ability and openness to share other concerns as well. Darren Brown has been involved at Chelsea and Westminster Hospital by utilizing some of these outcomes in evaluating a 10-week hospital-based physiotherapy-led exercise program called the Kobler Rehabilitation Class, of which Esther is involved with here on the panel as well. And there were 92 individuals referred to this 10-week exercise program that includes twice-weekly supervised exercise sessions as well as weekly self-management education sessions as well. And results from this evaluation found improvements in functional walk status, strength, physical and emotional well-being, flexibility, as well as 83% of the sample reporting attainment in their goals. But that was one particular context in a hospital-based setting, very highly supervised by very highly trained personnel. Here in Canada, we looked at the concept of readiness to begin to exercise, and this was a study I had the opportunity to collaborate with Sue Chan Carasoni at Casey House, working with a group of physio students who looked at the readiness to exercise among people living with HIV and multimorbidity. And the participants in this qualitative study, there were 14 interviews and individuals were living with a median of 9 concurrent conditions in addition to HIV. And the students identified that readiness is really a spectrum and it's influenced not only by the episodic nature of HIV, but potentially social supports, perceptions and beliefs about exercise, one's past experiences they've had with exercise, and accessibility to gyms and programs as well. From this work, we've been able to then sort of see how, you know, high-level evidence, systematic reviews, evidence that states that exercise is beneficial. But how does this actually play out when implementing it into the real-world community setting? And so we've had the opportunity to collaborate with the YMCA in Toronto to evaluate a community-based exercise program. And we piloted a 4-month intervention program where individuals exercise 3 times a week with once a week supervised instruction from a fitness coach with monthly self-management sessions embedded throughout. You can see here from the word cloud what many of the participants' goals were going into the particular study. And of the 28 participants who initiated the study, 19 completed, so 68%. And overall, among those individuals who did complete the program, the findings from the pilot were fairly positive, feeling that the CBE program was beneficial, the interaction and coaching from the fitness instructor was beneficial, and for the most part, 72% felt that they had achieved their goals or they were on the road in order to do so. So when thinking about how rehabilitation fits into this, it really brings me back to the definition that Kate talked about before, a dynamic process that includes very broadly any prevention or treatment activities or services that address those aspects of body impairments, activity limitations, and participation restrictions. We've heard a lot of terminology over the last couple of days, living strategies and how that relates to rehabilitation, self-management, community-based exercise, and community-based services, which may all be considered or linked in many ways. When I think about the cascade and the aspect and the role for rehabilitation, there's certainly the level of improving one's individual health, but then how that involves with one's interaction with the broader environment, as well as the broader determinants of health. So I think rehabilitation does have a role to address aspects of different health outcomes, indirectly influencing those aspects of the 90-90-90, again, in that context of the broader determinants of health. And lastly, just want to acknowledge all of the individuals who are involved in the work that was presented here today. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Kelly. So next we're going to hear from Matthew Halse, who's the Executive Director of ACCM, or the AIDS Community Care Montreal.
Hi. So before I begin, how do I use this? There we go. I have a couple of conflicts. I've sat on a couple of community advisory boards. Before I begin, a few notes. ACCM is Quebec's oldest ASO. We've been around, it's our 30th anniversary this year. As part of our newfound federal funding, we've been polling members about what the programming needs are, what they expect of us, especially on our support services side. We also run a prevention side. And HIV and aging programming, social programming, sexual health programming, but all linked to HIV and aging, was number one. And so this is an exciting time for us because I'm going to talk a little bit about the new programs that we're essentially launching this week. Before I begin, there's sort of three notes. And the first is that this should be exciting. This is a cluster of programming that, you know, my predecessors imagined that they worked for, that they should be congratulated on, and we're getting there. This is about viral suppression. This is about living healthy lives, but also, as Bob Leahy told me yesterday, this is about being aged with HIV, not just aging with HIV, and that's a tremendous milestone in this epidemic. The second thing I want to talk about is that no matter what program we outline, no matter what real-world consequence the policy recommendations ask for of us, it needs to be steeped in the meaningful involvement of people living with HIV and AIDS. And so the programming that I suggest here must come from the membership, not just in terms of governance, but also in terms of volunteer program, which we'll talk about. And so this is something that will impact us all. And the third thing is that HIV and aging programming and policy development brings all of us in this room together. It's not just engaging with AIDS service organizations or our funders or government policymakers, but it's bringing clinicians together. Dr. Falutz, for example, at ACCM in new and exciting ways. But it's also making AIDS service organizations engage with partners that we never thought that we would have. I had a call with the Alzheimer's Society of Canada for the first time. These are new things that we need to start thinking about. So I thought I'd take my few minutes and highlight two goals. So the first is to maybe poke some holes at the ways in which policy development translates into programming. And so that's also why I'm gonna start, I'm sort of the bad news guy, and I wanna start with the excitement. And the second is to talk about a few of the ways in which ACCM has factored in some of these barriers to programming, or these hurdles, I should say, in our own cluster of programming that we're launching effectively right now, and learning how to do it sort of as we go along. The first is just to acknowledge that there are, in fact, barriers to HIV and aging programs. Policy does not necessarily translate directly into programming at the service level. It is geographically dependent. It is dependent on your membership. At ACCM, we have a significantly aging membership. And so just to sort of take a step back and say, there can be some problems. And that's what I kind of like to talk about. The first of which is economic. We think about rehabilitation often, not exclusively, within the context of back-to-work programs. I've actually had many conversations about back-to-work programs today alone. And part of the thing that we need to think about is that work, especially part-time work, may actually be economically detrimental to our membership. Often it's honoraria-based back-to-work programs or part-time work take away from that person's disability payments and leave them more economically precarious. So I want to think about that. And so my answer to this is to start thinking about volunteerism as well, an implication not only within the organization, but in terms of mentorship to the next generation of people living with HIV and to the community at large. I want to talk a little bit about skills. Policy recommendations right now that and Realize really does have an excellent guide, sometimes breach into a one-size-fit-all model. And the problem is that people often either need prerequisite skills to enter rehabilitation programs or HIV and aging programs that we need to address. So often, I'll stick with the job creation programs, often what happens is people, you know, go right to making a CV or go right to computer literacy, and we really need to back up and recognize that our members and the people who use our services might not quite be there. And so we need to evaluate our programs and our grant creation based on that knowledge that, for example, mobility might be a factor, or social aptitude and the ability to socialize within the context of a service organization like ACCM may impact access to those programs themselves. And the other thing is that, as we're talking quite a bit about polypharmacy at ACCM, is that HIV and aging programs are not just conditioned on HIV. It is exciting, but people are aging in ways that we're just kind of discovering. And I think, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I think Dr. Falutz will probably touch on it a little bit, but things like frailty come into play. Things like drug interactions that far exceed our capacity at service organizations to discuss, but they impact the capacity of that person to access our services. So on one hand, we're super excited to have these newfound programs, these exercise programs, these back to work programs, but we need to acknowledge the variety of other factors that happen with somebody aging beyond the HIV conversation. We need to develop programs at the service level that have graduated levels of instruction. This is incredibly difficult because grants, as we all know, and for some of us who just went through the federal process, are often one size fit all. And so we need to find ways at the service provision level to incorporate a variety of learning levels, a variety of knowledge levels within a single program. Now, our answer at ACCM, I'm kind of getting ahead of myself, but our answer at ACCM is to pair people up and have buddy programs that meaningfully involve people living with HIV within the programs that we're developing. So this allows for us to have a large-scale program, and I'll mention some of them in a minute, but to incorporate people at different knowledge levels within the process so that they feel comfortable, one, and so that they keep coming back. We need to acknowledge, too, that these programs that we are proposing, these policy developments that we're proposing, don't always factor in other social determinants. And so Kelly's mentioned a few of them, and a few of them were mentioned in the 90-90-90 lunch discussion, but things like food impacts somebody's ability to, or access to, rather, impacts somebody's ability to enter those programs. And so one of my hopes that I can pass on as ACCM embarks on this cluster initiatives is to have things like food available. It not only promotes that sense of food security, but it allows people to enter rehabilitation that might not necessarily be able to because of that kind of barrier. The other thing is stigma. The criminalization protest that happened earlier is incredibly poignant. People who are living with HIV, particularly who are aging with HIV, are encountering stigma in new and unfound ways. I'm hearing as we enter into seniors' homes in this cluster program, resistance from staff to engage with people aging with HIV. I'm hearing people being afraid to re-enter the dating market. And these are impacting the ability to have the service provision. A quick overview of what we're actually doing at ACCM. So we have two clusters of programs funded by PHAC and ESDC, and they're essentially about community building. So one that we're doing right now is a computer literacy program where people are going to be able to pair up with buddies, so it's incorporating volunteers who are living with HIV with, older members, to experience Facebook, to experience social media, to experience dating apps, in new and safe ways. Now, later on in that program, we're going to transition into job development, but we're really going to start with the social building. We have a series of Monday night talks called Dinner and Discussion, which are member-led community meals, so we're really thinking about that food security piece, while members choose topics to build capacity in some sort of way. So an example of this is we've recently done one on dystrophy, so members We're tasked with, you know, engaging clinicians, asking questions, and then bringing it back to the group on Monday and presenting on a topic that deeply impacts their understanding of their own aging process. And I've mentioned it already, but we're starting to enter into seniors' homes, say CHSLD in Montreal, to engage with staff. That's HIV 101, that's Stigma 101, that's HCV 101, to get them to build a certain level of acceptance of people living with HIV. Now, to close it up, just some things to keep in mind when you're building these programs, or if you're a clinician and engaging with people like me who run organizations, is that the policies are one thing, but the needs must come from your membership. Please don't forget to ask. HIV aging programs only work if people want to engage with them. Grants are one size fit all, but programming does not need to be. You can build clusters within it, and you can use your volunteers, as I've said, to manage multiple levels of knowledge use. Always start off with the implication of people living with HIV, and focus on what's exciting. This should not be about overcoming barriers, but it should be about living a life like to its fullest, even at the latest stages. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Matthew. So next, I'm going to call up Larry Baxter, who's a community member from Nova Scotia. Larry.
Thank you very much, Kate, and thank you for the opportunity to participate in this very important discussion. I have nothing to disclose. That's the joy of being a retired volunteer. I took a different approach to my participation on this panel today. I'm going to be the curious layperson, and I'm going to come with a perspective of a bunch of questions, and I have some simple slides. As a community member who has seen many prevention and treatment programs come and go over the years, I was intrigued when I heard the 1990 campaign. I like neat, orderly math concepts. So, and before I move on, I want to acknowledge that the noon panel did acknowledge a lot of concentrated efforts that have taken place to date. But when I applied the math, and it's 90% of 90% of 90%, that only gives us 73%. And so the outcome doesn't sound as great when you look at that target. Then when I read the Public Health Agency of Canada's, what they gave as the estimate of the current rates of 80%, 76%, and 89%, that mathematically works out around 56%. So this clearly shows that the challenges of testing, of getting people into treatment and keeping them there, compound each other and affect these outcomes. The sequence of the treatment cascade makes good sense on paper. And I was glad to hear at noon that the 90-90-90 is just, they see it as just the initial targets. But I wondered to myself, why weren't they 99, 99, and 90? And so I have some questions, and they're a bit to help with this provocative title for my slide presentation. Are we seeing the 90-90-90 strategy from every aspect of the individual, the patient, the client? Are the doctor's office and the aid service organizations really reaching everyone? Do we need to be more creative in our accessing the hard to reach? And most important of all for this afternoon is, can rehabilitation services play a role? Now, I must state my bias. When I heard the term rehabilitation as prevention, I had a gut reaction that we had something of value that can contribute to achieve 90-90-90. I start with the belief that our traditional and complementary rehabilitation services can have a role to play in every step along the cascade. So to better understand how rehabilitation can play a prevention role, a meaningful role, I will look at two things this afternoon. One is that the person or the individual, and also what's behind the cascade as how it affects the daily life of the person. So in trying to make sense of why the treatment cascade is not mathematically 99, 99, 90, I look back over my experiences with other positive persons and my work with various AIDS service organizations and during my term as the chair of the Nova Scotia Advisory Commission on AIDS. My biggest learning and insight was this: one must not fall into that easy frame of mind where you believe that everyone thinks and acts like you do and your colleagues. That pitfall can create such statements like, I rank my health as one of the top three goals of my life. I'm aware that everything I do with my body and my mind is important for my health. I want to be in charge of my health, and I'm an enthusiastic self-manager. And I can find the resources and the means to look after myself and overcome any challenges. By stepping back and viewing the concept of health from a variety of perspectives, we can begin to see why and how we need to approach testing, care, and treatment in different ways. If staying healthy and fit is my concept of health, the traditional approaches to prevention and treatment probably will work perfectly for me. But does the medical model have the same appeal and the accessibility for me if I see my health from a different angle? Perhaps I'm more interested or motivated by the quality of my life experiences and how I live them. Or I just want to have as many different experiences as I can as I get older and older. Maybe I prefer not to know anything about my health, as I fear being ill and incapacitated. Or just maybe I have other important things going on in my life, such as violence, homelessness, hunger, etc. The treatment cascade works best for the enthusiastic self-manager, but not everyone fits into this type of person or patient. I have met some active participants in their health who also just need some extra help. Then I've come across others who are passive participants in their health, and they need more than support. They need prodding and encouragement. And as if we've all met through this epidemic, there are those who are still deniers, refusers, or non-participants. While there may be very legitimate reasons years ago for these decisions, we need to better understand the context of their decisions in today's treatment world, where undetectable equals untransmittable, but always through the human rights lens. As well, I have learned that not every positive person, for whatever reason, is in the regular contact with a local AIDS service organization or has confidence in their local HIV clinic. And the last slide. Based on Kate's definition of rehabilitation, I really look at it in a very broad sense. So it's the traditional, such as physiotherapy and occupational therapy. There's also the complementary therapies, such as yoga and massage, but then there's social services and mental health services. The approach of a patient-centered rehabilitation should look at these services or activities from what the individual wants to get out of it. So now let's look at a group of community-based services that exist in Halifax, which were designed for the hard-to-reach and hard-to-serve populations. And last night during the Mark Weinberg lecture, We heard a similar scenario, and this at noon also we heard some scenarios. So in Halifax, there's the MOSH, or the Mobile Outreach Street Health Project, which works with people from a van on the street. Now, besides providing basic nursing and education services, they also provide testing, a variety of tests, sometimes with point of care testing when it's possible for them to do it, but it's there for where and when the people are ready to be tested. They've added an outreach worker, who is an occupational therapist, to their team, who will handle counseling and referrals for those who need extra supports beyond the on-the-spot nursing care. Direction 180 is one of the community referral points, which provides low-threshold methadone treatment. It's also an access point for testing, a dispensing spot for HIV medications, if the client does not feel comfortable using the local HIV clinic or going to the pharmacy at the big hospital across the city. Housing Helps is an offshoot service for the local services, which provides coordinated support services, getting people into stable, suitable housing and providing financial guardianship when required. Housing is key for people who want to stay in care and stay on treatment. Other referrals include a local food bank and the court support services. So these are all examples of rehabilitation type services helping clients stay in the treatment cascade. So for our existing rehabilitation services, we should assess them to see how they can reach some of the groups who are at higher risk for HIV infection. So here are some questions to ask ourselves about our rehabilitation services. Can they provide information on HIV prevention or provide encouragement for someone to access that information? Can they promote the local convenient testing sites? In future, could rehab sites also provide access to rapid testing or a place to pick up take-home testing kits? Could they promote the periodic testing campaigns? Could they help normalize routine testing as well as other screening programs? Rehab professionals usually have a lot more face time with their clients, giving them the potential to understand what else is going on in their lives and to encourage them to link with care and to suggest referrals and in some cases to act as the outreach connector. Adherence is a real challenge for many. Each rehabilitation service should be a part of a case management team to help with the special assistance programs that provide psychosocial support or to assist with special peer or buddy programs. So as mentioned by others and at noon, that stigma, discrimination, poverty, food security, insecurity, homelessness, mental health, and addiction service are all issues. And if you want to know more about those, Katie had a great article in their spring 2013 prevention and focus that was entitled "The Treatment Cascade, Patching the Leaks to Improve HIV Prevention." So with that note, I want to say thank you very much for the opportunity, and I look forward to the rest of the presentations.
Thank you, Larry, for that community perspective on where rehabilitation providers can play a role across the cascade. So I'd now like to invite Dr. Julian Falutz, who is a physician in the Comprehensive HIV and Aging Initiative, or the CHAI Clinic, at the McGill University Health Center.
Thank you very much, Kate, for the opportunity to share some information with you this afternoon related to geriatric syndromes in aging people living with HIV. I have no conflicts of interest to report for this presentation. We know that life expectancy is almost the same for most people with HIV as in the general population. It's people who are diagnosed now at the age of 20, our mathematical modeling predicts that they will live to about 70. Obviously, there's cofactors involved which may increase or decrease this overall mean survival. What's interesting to note is that there's some suggestion that people who have an undetectable HIV viral load, as well as a CD4 count above 500 for about 5 years, are expected to have a normal long-term survival, the same as that of seronegative individuals. The result of this, as well as the fact that, as was mentioned before, people are getting infected with HIV at older age, is that the mean age of people living with HIV is increasing. So a couple of years ago, 30% were over the age of 50, but now 75% in the next 10 years are expected to be older than 50. It's about a 250% increase. In 2010, 8% were older than 60. That is anticipated to increase to 40% older than 60 by 2030, a 500% increase in this older population. So the question is, why is the overall survival of effectively treated older HIV patients still decreased compared to the overall population? And there's a number of explanations for this. We can count the premature development of age-related comorbidities, the question of whether we have accelerated or accentuated aging. That's not what I'm going to talk about today. But we also see that there's an increased risk of the early development of typical geriatric syndromes. Both of these, the comorbidities and the geriatric syndromes, may well be related to an ongoing immune activation and chronic inflammation, which we're not going to talk about this afternoon. So what are geriatric syndromes? Well, they're conditions that don't fit easily into the usual sort of medical model, the usual discrete disease categories. They have multifactorial etiologies, and they involve multiple organ systems with significant downstream sequelae. What we refer to in geriatrics as the geriatric giants, the geriatric syndromes. We're talking about frailty, impaired mobility and falls, cognitive impairment, sensory impairment, impaired bowel and bladder function, and polypharmacy. These are the usual ones, though there are others that can be identified. A recent paper by Meredith Green from UCSF showed that some of these typical syndromes occur very commonly in the HIV population at UCSF. Depression is present in about 40%. Falls were reported in about a quarter of individuals. Mobility impairment in about 20-25% of individuals. So these are very common conditions that we don't usually think about from the medical model, but are clearly getting a lot of attention at the present time. So let's just briefly talk about frailty. How can we define it? In the most general sense, it's a state of increased vulnerability to stressors occurring in the elderly. And it's related to decreased physiological reserve, which increases the risk of negative outcomes in a variety of different parameters. It is associated with a chronic inflammatory state in the general population. And it can be operationalized by using a number of different classifications. As we often see in medicine, there isn't one easy way to diagnose frailty. The two most common ways we have is the so-called frailty phenotype and the frailty index, which I won't go into detail with. However, what we see in the context of HIV is that low nadir CD4s increase the risk of being frail, that the prevalence of being frail in untreated HIV, HIV-positive males in their 50s, is similar to that of HIV-negative individuals about 10 years older. Asymptomatic HIV males who are frail before beginning HART were more likely to develop AIDS or to die after they began HART. We understand that frailty is a dynamic process. You can be frail according to either of the usual metrics that we use on one time, and maybe 6 months later, you may not meet the criteria for frailty. But being HIV positive, the evidence suggests that you're more likely to continuously be frail. And we know, according to some recent papers, that frailty predicts the development of multi-morbidity. That is, that you have more than two comorbidities at the present time. What are the consequences of frailty? Increased risk of hospitalization, multi-morbidity and disability, malnutrition, loss of independence, increased risk of cognitive decline, and an overall increased mortality rate. What about mobility impairment and falls? What's the role, their role in functional decline? Functional status, as was mentioned at the beginning, is the ability, one of the definitions, not the only one, is the ability to perform ADLs and IADLs to maintain safety and independence. The tools to assess these can predict morbidity and mortality in the elderly. Some of the tools that we use are the so-called short physical performance battery, the 400-meter walk time, the 6-meter walk distance, the timed up and go, and hand grip strength. And these are various metrics that when we apply, which will give us a sense of the increased risk of the individual. We know that slow gait does predict functional decline, including decreased cognition. People living with AIDS, with HIV, experience earlier and faster gait speed decline than controls, and this is linked to nadir CD4 count. There's decreased survival in HIV-positive injection drug users who have a worse SSPB score. There's increased prevalence of impaired lower limb strength and muscle in 40-year-old people living with HIV, which is similar to the prevalence that we see in people 20 years older without HIV. Hand grip strength appears to decrease more rapidly across age levels in people with HIV. And the common risk factors in the general population are the same as in people with HIV. And interestingly, HIV parameters may not be involved in some of these outcomes. Briefly, I want to just mention polypharmacy, which the definition is taking any more than five non-HIV prescription medications. We realize that people take either one pill a day or several pills a day for their antiretrovirals. In the general population, falls are associated with the use of about four different drugs. Disability is associated with the use of five drugs, and frailty in the general population is associated with the use of six or more drugs. Polypharmacy in patients with HIV occurs more commonly than age-matched individuals who are HIV negative. But polypharmacy is not new to people with HIV. Look at the picture on the left. You'll see these were just the antiretrovirals that people were taking in the first generation. And we all remember the three times, four times a day, carefully taken medication that have to be, that were people were taking. Today we only have one often HIV pill that has to be taken, but we often forget the non-medically prescribed drugs which contribute to polypharmacy. Many of the concurrent comorbidities, cardiovascular disease, bone disease, et cetera, may require drug therapy on their own, and we often forget about over-the-counter drugs, recreational drugs, et cetera, when talking about polypharmacy. And the risks of polypharmacy include decreased overall adherence to antiretrovirals, the number increased risk of adverse drug effects, drug and drug interactions, increased risk of having developing geriatric syndromes in the presence of polypharmacy, increased risk of hospitalizations, falls, and mortality. We know that sensory impairment is another significant problem that occurs in people with HIV, which can increase the risk of falls, isolation, impaired quality of life. We know that evidence recently suggests that visual impairment occurs more commonly in patients with HIV. Hearing impairment is common. Neuropathy is an underappreciated problem, as is chronic pain, which is only now getting a lot of the attention that it deserves. I just want to very briefly talk about cognitive decline, and basically just to mention that not only are there all the HIV-related factors that we've heard about which can contribute to cognitive decline, but as people get older, vascular risk factors can contribute to cognitive decline, and there's obviously the age-associated increase in typical Alzheimer's disease. So all of these are interrelated and will be impacting on patients aging with HIV. Disability is more common in people with HIV, either basic activities of daily living or instrumental activities or daily living are more common, occur more often in people with HIV than an HIV negative of the same age. So the unanswered question is, are the 50s the new 70s in the setting of HIV? Do they have to be? And is successful aging with HIV possible? And the answer is yes. We have to diagnose HIV early. We have to treat rationally. We have to manage risks to avoid the development of multimorbidity, minimize the risks of developing polypharmacy, manage risks for functional and cognitive decline, adapt rehabilitation-based assessment and interventions to limit the impairments caused by the geriatric syndromes I've just discussed. And one of the most important things is to proactively introduce interdisciplinary management principles, to have a social worker, an occupational therapist, a pharmacist, a physiotherapist, as well as the absolutely necessary peer and community support groups. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Julian. And now we're actually going to hear about some of those rehabilitation interventions. So I'd like to welcome Esther McDonnell, who's an occupational therapist at the Chelsea and Westminster Hospital in the UK.
Thank you, Kate, and I'd like to thank the CIHR and CAHR for organizing this special session and inviting me to be part of it. So, when I first started thinking about this topic, no conflict of interest to declare. Thinking about the cascade. And I thought, the 90%, is this what we're thinking the 90% are, the people who are strong, healthy, fit, and don't have rehabilitation needs, as opposed to the 10% who are frail, weak, and have lots of rehabilitation needs? And it doesn't actually, I don't think that's a very useful way of looking at it, because I don't think the world is black and white. And although we have these two extremes at either end of the poles, in fact, there's an awful lot of people in between that, and that's where rehabilitation needs lie. So, who needs rehabilitation? I come from a lens very much, I work in an acute hospital, so we see people who are acutely unwell. And I recently had a quick look through who was on our wards over the past couple of months and tried to categorise people in the patients into several different categories. So people with acute illness, and those included people who were on the cascade, who are in the 90% who are virally suppressed, but also people who are off that, whether that is long-term poor adherence or new diagnosis at late stage HIV. People with multiple morbidities, so whether those are aging related, but also we're actually an HIV cancer center, so we see a lot of people living with cancer who are in hospital for their treatment or with complications from the treatment. So those are the three broad categories of people that I see in my direct work. I also, as has been mentioned before, I'm involved in the Kobler Rehabilitation Class, which is physical exercise with a self-management program. And though the people attending that, I would say, fall into the multiple morbidity, so partly that they're becoming older, but also have a number of health conditions, some of which might be after an acute illness or after treatment for cancer. And I started to think, well, we've got our treatment, our HIV treatment cascade, but actually do we need to think about having a rehabilitation cascade, and what would that look like? So we'd have an acute hospital stage of rehabilitation where we're really focusing on discharge from hospital and looking at basic safety, basic needs, so mobility, self-care. What can we do right now, but also what can we set up outside of this setting to support those needs? A rehabilitation hospital where it's purely focused on rehabilitation as opposed to the medical management alongside it. However, there's often there are a limited number of spaces and criteria may be difficult to meet. In London, we're very lucky to have a place called the Mildmay UK, which is an HIV neurocognitive rehabilitation hospital. However, they're not part of the regular funding, so funding isn't always available for people to be admitted there. And the other thing that we often come to, when we're looking at our patients on the ward, thinking about where to discharge and whether or not rehabilitation in hospitals would be appropriate, is age. They are often more for, the patients in the rehab hospitals are often older than our cohort of patients, and thinking about whether or not that dynamic would work and if that's in the person's best interest. Rehabilitation at home, this is preferred option by the commissioners or the funders, and the patients as well often report that they would rather be at home, and so there's lots of short-term programs of rehabilitation to assist people to leave hospital quickly. And then rehabilitation in community settings, and I think this is the point where I really like to focus on the realised definition of rehabilitation. So we've got this, I think 100% of people with living with HIV may fall into any of these different parts of the rehabilitation cascade, whether they are part of the 90% who are diagnosed on treatment and suppressed, or whether they're 10% who are undiagnosed. And so there's lots of opportunities for rehabilitation providers to assist in working on this cascade. But people at any stage of the care cascade, and I guess the flip side is also true, that people at any stage of the care cascade may also need rehabilitation. So, rehabilitation interventions. When I first started working as an occupational therapist, a patient said to me, "You know, you shouldn't call yourself an occupational therapist. That's confusing. I think you mean going to get a job. You should call yourself a life coach." And I actually quite like that term. And I think it frames an awful lot of what I do in, or how I approach my work in the hospital setting. So looking at rebuilding people from both their physical, cognitive, and social point of view. Problem solving. And educating, whether that is the patient themselves, my multidisciplinary team members, whether it is other service providers, whether that's community care providers or rehabilitation providers, about what HIV is, why rehabilitation is necessary and appropriate. And I've lost my notes. But also students, I'm involved in teaching students to prepare them for working with people living with HIV. A little bit about the UK context. I'm sure this is a very familiar situation across the world at the moment. You may have heard, so austerity has been the approach of our current government for some years now, so reducing public spending on all sorts of programs, including health and social care, and a little thing called Brexit, which I don't want to go into, but I think it's going to be a disaster from both a staffing point of view, but also thinking about costs of treatments. And there is, so this comes up to an NHS crisis, the NHS being the National Health Service, which was set up in 1948 as a free at the point of care service for people, for all people in the UK who are entitled to it. But yes, so that's the background, I guess, a little bit to that. This has resulted or coincided with some changes to HIV services. People living with HIV in the UK have traditionally accessed their HIV doctor as their general practitioner or family practitioner, family doctor, and had all their medications and gone to them with any ailments. And that has, there's been a big move away from that, and the HIV services are only able to prescribe HIV drugs now, and everything is put back to family doctors, everything else. There's also been reduction in traditional rehab services. So there used to be a number of physios and OTs working around the UK, and particularly in London, in specific HIV jobs, and these have been whittled down. And also changes to community services, part of austerity in terms of reduction of provision and changes in the way that's done. Finally, I was asked to talk about palliative care and a palliative thinking about people who are having virological failure and immunological failure from their HIV, and who, so maybe they're in the 90% engaged in care but haven't achieved or unable to achieve 90% the other part. So this group of people still have rehabilitation needs. This is a picture of a lady called Dame Cicely Saunders, who's known in the UK as the founder of the modern hospice movement. And she championed the holistic care needs of people who were dying. And she has a quote, which I think was, it really spoke to me in when we're thinking about the care cascade, that we will help you to live until you die. And I think that regardless of whether someone has HIV, whether they're where they are on the cascade, this is really important, that rehabilitation services should assist people to live until they die. So that's my answer. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Esther. And last but not least, I'd like to invite Colm Bergin, who's a consultant physician in infectious diseases at St. James's Hospital in Dublin.
Thanks, Kate. So good evening, and I'm conscious that I'm not going to keep you till too late, but firstly to thank Kirk, Carr, Realize, and Kelly for the invitation to attend this meeting both yesterday and today. I'm a full-time clinician in academic practice in St. James's Hospital and in Trinity College Dublin. And in preparing for this talk, really tricky, like Esther, our HIV services have significantly changed. I should mention I have no conflicts of interest for the purpose of this talk. But our HIV services have changed in the latter years. When I was training in HIV medicine, we had a physio, an OT, a nutritionist, and an MDT team. Of two pharmacists. Now we have seven pharmacists, no physio, no OT, no speech therapist, and a medical team. So I was taken by Kelly's commentary relating to the percentage of people who will have had access to speech therapy, physio, and OT in the last year. That's clearly a zero, zero, and zero for the patients who attend us. The second issue is that most of our patients don't have primary care providers. We have no provision of HIV care in the community. All HIV care is provided through hospital-based centres. There are five of them in the country, and half of the patients have no GPs, so they attend us for both primary and secondary care delivery. But that said, I found the meeting very informative and reflective, and as I make my flight home tomorrow, I will be thinking about things that I learned both yesterday and in the talks from this session. In the brief time that I have, I want to talk just about some things that we are starting in trying to address individual care needs in the context of a very heterogeneous population who attend us, and some of the things that we have been putting in place around social inclusion health, successful aging with our partners in geriatric medicine, and then some evidence-based work that we're doing in our research facility. So this is just a pictorial of present HIV care in Ireland. Notifications are on the up in the last number of years, primarily driven by the MSM population, half of whom come from Latin America. So the drive is both related to MSM within the indigenous population, but also as a consequence of migration. Significantly, we've had an increase in injection drug use outbreaks in the last year, and notably, the CT4 count at time of presentation varies across the three groups. So we have a very heterogeneous group within the country, and within our own department of almost 2,800 patients, our divide is almost 40-40-20. 10% of all new diagnoses in the country last year were over the age of 50 at point of diagnosis. So I think the key points to take home from HIV in Ireland are the increase in rates of new notifications, so something is not working. We don't have PrEP. It is licensed, obviously, through the European Medicines Authority, but the government does not reimburse it, so people are buying it online for those that can afford it. Notably, the age breakdown is identified. Almost half of the new cases were born outside of the Irish Republic, so they're obviously migrating for either economic or personal reasons, and a significant percentage of those people had been diagnosed prior to their migration to the country. The thing that I've reflected most on in the last 24 hours is the whole gain of collaboration and partnerships, whether that be within an evidence-based research or whether that be with community partners and patient groups. And historically, our research and evidence-based to HIV care in Ireland has been very monothematic, and very little of it has been related to comorbidity. So we have been very, I suppose, invested in individual disease areas associated with HIV care, but in the context of aging, multiple morbidities, and impact on quality of life change, I think that now changes in the context of geriatric model of care delivery, as Julian had talked to. So I work in the department of two services jointly merged, GU Medicine, which is a specialty of sexual health and HIV medicine and infectious diseases, which was not available as a specialty in the country until 2001. And we provide care to almost 2,800 patients in the department. So this is our cascade of care, and I think the only thing this has done for us is to reflect on the people who are not engaged or in the people who are not attaining the goal. So about 4,800 people have been registered to the department at any time point. We've lost a number of people to death. This is since the start of the department in 1988, and we've lost a significant number of people through transfers. We have no national disease registry, so we have no knowledge of where people are actually moving to, other than the fact that they have had no recording of a viral load in the National Virus Reference Laboratory over the last 10 years. In the second bar, the top small part is the group that we want to focus most to. This represents about 500 people whom we have lost to care and whom we have put some efforts in place trying to determine how best to retain them to care or at least to locate them. For those that are actually attending care, obviously they're doing well. So 98% of our cohort are receiving therapy, hence the upsurge of pharmacists within our MDT team, and just over 90% of that cohort are virologically suppressed. I should mention, in addition to having no community care provision for HIV, all our medicines are dispensed through the hospital pharmacies. We provide outreach pharmacies to the prisons and to the methadone clinics. Within the area where I work, it is an area of significant social deprivation. Cleaner was here yesterday talking to work associated with super utilizers. Amongst our 500 people who we are looking to re-link to care, we have 22 super utilizers who have accounted for 2% of all admissions to the hospital in the last year. And clearly, social deprivation is a strong association with virological failure despite the benefits of antiviral therapy. So those people suffer from multiple issues associated with stigma and exclusion, most of which have been talked to by people who have already given talks. Within the inner city area where I work, obviously homelessness, drinking, alcohol, violence, housing, food access, and significant mental health comorbidities significantly impact on that cohort's ability to attain the goal of viral suppression as a single measure of their disease care. We have been doing some things to look at enabling integration. So on the right is the easiest. This is the portal for Patient Knows Best. So this has been a very successful integration for patients who have access to IT and systems and are able to access their own electronic health records, their results. They can book their own appointments. And we have extended this to the haemophilia cohort who attend us, given that they receive funding from the state specific to their haemophilia, not because they are HIV. We have looked at geomapping, similar to the work that Michelle Obama led in diabetes care in Chicago, where we have looked at linking all our areas of residence, our individual patients, to healthcare services within the community to try and link in an outreach manner to provision of care. And we have adapted the ECHO model from Sanjeev Arora for hepatitis C to complex ECHO care, trying to partner with community providers around knowledge exchange and linkage to the difficult to treat patient cohorts. We have introduced the Stanford model of chronic care disease, but this is simply be to the haemophilia cohort. There are 17 HIV-positive haemophiliacs now in the national cohort, so the haemophilia department have adapted this model as a mechanism of care integration with their patient cohort. This is not available to the other 2,683 patients who attend us. However, things are good. So this big building on the left, on the right of this picture is the Mercer's Institute for Successful Aging, an initiative funded by Atlantic Philanthropy and the government. And the building on the left of your picture is the clinic where we work. So we're waiting for the knocking ball to come to knock down the building because it's obviously aesthetically disturbing, the beautiful building that's on the right. But much more importantly, apart from the environment in which we look after patients, is the fact that we will partner with aging now as we go forward. So somebody has already referenced the difference between biological aging and chronological aging. These are two people of the same age, and we're clearly interested in looking at both chronology of aging, but also the biology and the determinants to quality of aging, not just the chronology at the time of death. Tilda is the longitudinal aging cohort established by Roseanne Kenny in Dublin. It follows over 5,000 people over the age of 50, and we have the opportunity now to partner HIV into that longitudinal cohort. This is the work that Cleena will work to. She presented some of her findings at the workshop meeting yesterday. And finally, in our clinical research facility, so this is a totally standalone building, again funded outside of health services funding, we have been able to look at some interventions in small numbers. We've undertaken an exercise program similar to that of Darren and Kelly's, where we took 16 patients of our cognitively impaired cohort. We had a prevalence of 50% amongst a cohort of 600 people screened for cognitive impairment over the age of 40, and we brought them through an exercise program of 16 weeks duration in the physiotherapy and physiology suite in the CRF. The biggest challenge to us there was completion of the program. 60% of people only finished. And secondly, people's wish not to exercise with other HIV patients. So retention within the exercise program was actually affected by stigma of diagnosis. So finally, again, with support from Darren and Esther in Chelsea, we are funding a master's student in physiotherapy who we hope will start an intervention proposal around exercise intervention that hopefully, if successful, may become adaptable to the larger patient cohort. Thank you.
Wow. Thanks, Colm. That was a lot of information in a really short time. So we probably don't have much time for a community conversation, though I would suggest that our panelists will stick around for a few minutes if there are questions or you want to chat to us about various programs and services in rehabilitation in the context of HIV and aging. But I just want to quickly summarize some of what we heard today, which was that rehabilitation has potentially a role across the continuum of aging and across the treatment and care cascade. We heard Larry refer to rehabilitation as prevention. We heard the question often, is rehabilitation for anyone or everyone living with HIV? And I think there are different circumstances under which it would be appropriate for people living with HIV at all stages to access rehabilitation services. I think we learned that sometimes rehabilitation is called by other names. We had a conversation yesterday at our self-management meeting about harm reduction really also being another word or another term for self-management. And I think rehabilitation is often couched within community support services. And there's also then a role for professional rehabilitation providers. And I just want to quickly finish by saying that if you visit the Realize website, you can find links to a variety of resources on HIV, aging, and rehabilitation, including an e-module for evidence-informed HIV rehabilitation, which is a training module publicly accessible to anyone, reports on HIV and aging, but also links to various research pieces as well. And finally, I'd just like to thank CIHR for providing the funding, the Institute of Aging, for providing the funding for this special session. I'd love to thank Kelly, Matthew, Larry, Julian, Esther, and Colm. And again, thank Kirk, Realize, and CAHR for allowing us to have this session today. I don't know if they're going to turn off the mics, but you can try to ask questions if you want.
Sure. Hi. My name is Sherry. I'm a 55-year-old woman living with HIV for 25 years. And I don't see, first of all, thank you all for coming and preparing what you have. I see very little in what is being shown here that will help me in any way. I saw nothing for women at all, really. I did see that power sign, but 2 years ago, I was that guy on the walker. So I didn't see anything at all. I didn't feel that myself or other women living with HIV who are my age were reflected in any of this presentation at all. And I really highly encourage you to consider that we are part of the population who is older and living with HIV, and our needs are quite different than anything pretty much that I saw on this board. I really didn't feel that this was for me, and I'm really kind of disappointed, actually.
Thanks for that comment, Sherry. Does any panelist want to respond to that, Kelly?
Just I mean, I echo and understand your comment. I think one of the lessons learned that we've had piloting the exercise program just being in Toronto is, you know, the lesson learned that there is not one size that fits all when we're talking about rehabilitation interventions. I can speak specifically to the context of the community-based exercise study going on at the YMCA, and we have made efforts with respect to recruitment, and you know, I think there's been a lot of barriers, and it's not a one-size-fits-all model, and it's we've learned with a lot of challenges that particularly we've had with respect to recruiting women. So we've actually been talking to the YMCA about ways that we might modify and identify maybe some ways to adapt the intervention and maybe tailor it to specific subgroup populations, because I think particularly for women, the feedback we've received is it's very difficult to them for them to physically get to the facility if they don't live geographically very close, and also to take away time from other responsibilities, whether it be work or parenting roles as well. So sort of trying to think about some other outside of the box, different ways to adopt that intervention. So I thank you for your comment, and it resonates.
Thanks, Kelly. Anyone else?
Yeah, I have a question. My name is Mona, I'm a public health nurse in Northern Alberta. It's interesting. Presentation. So it sounds like, or it looks like, HIV is taking a chronic, it's a chronic disease. So are we taking a chronic disease approach to it? Meaning, do HIV clinic, do they have to have OT, SLP, and physiotherapist? Or do we even have a clinic in Canada that does have that kind of approach? That's the first part of my question. Second part, what about a person who's HIV positive but doesn't have any of the risk factor mentioned, meaning middle class, working, they have social support, not a smoker, non-IV drug users. I look in the research and I don't see anything regarding aging with somebody who's middle class and not the typical risk factors involved. So when I ask other clinician in HIV clinic, and not everybody, they're like, oh, you can exercise, you can eat healthy, and you will prevent that. So yeah, thank you.
Sorry, Mona, was there a question within that? You were asking about whether there are interdisciplinary clinics.
Yeah, it's an interdisciplinary clinic. The other one would be, if you're HIV positive, yep, and without the risk factor, is your does it look like you're gonna get the comorbidity that we looked at? Like excluding the risk factor that we mentioned, you exercise, you eat healthy, are you still gonna develop the comorbidity? Meaning, is your 55 HIV positive gonna look like a 65 non-HIV positive if you excluded the risk factor involved? Like, what can we tell somebody who's HIV positive and doesn't have the risk factor that you mentioned? What am I going to be? Am I HIV positive? So what am I gonna have if I grow old? Am I going to get all the risk, all the diseases that you mentioned?
Yep.
Even though that I work, I do have a good social support, you know,
thanks,
I'm healthy, et cetera.
Yeah, thanks for clarifying. I think Julian's gonna respond to that.
Thank you for the very relevant question. We're very good at telling what happens to 1,000 people. We're not that good at telling the person in front of us what's going to happen to them. In the general population, the idea of successful aging goes along with not having the negative risk factors that you've just mentioned. It seems to be very similar in HIV, along with starting being diagnosed with HIV early, not waiting, especially if you're an older person, because that has an impact on your immune status when you're finally diagnosed. When you're diagnosed, if you're ready, you should be encouraged to start immediately, because that will impact on the biological aspects of your HIV, which themselves can contribute to some of those negative outcomes. So what we can say is that the fewer risk factors you have, the more likely you are to have successful aging and to have not only a normal survival, but also a successful survival. It's not just the time, but what you do with it. So it's very hard to the person in front of you to predict what's going to happen in them in 20 years, other than we know, for example, if you're, just as an example, it comes off the top of my head, if you're a male, 50% of males will have heart disease, no matter what you do, okay? That's life, et cetera, with all the other things. But there are cofactors that you can do, both biological, genetic, environmental, lifestyle, whatever, that you can do. So it's very similar to HIV positive and HIV negative, along with the specific factors which we have to pay particular attention to in HIV.
Okay, I think we have one more question and then we have to wrap it up.
For me, it's not a question, it's a comment. My name is Chantal Mukandoli, come from Toronto. So, my expertise and my experience I have, aging for me, I say, is a number. Because I remember I came to Canada, I was in the list of a youth. For now, I'm in the list of 50 plus. But if it become HIV, it's a big issue. So, comment in the, and the question is similar. So my comment is to think about gay men, aging, and HIV. What do we do to put it together, to understand together, to give that person, gay man, who is older and older enough to fight her stigma and her discrimination? What do we do together? Thank you.
Thank you. So I think what you're asking about is the layers of that onion that come together when you add together HIV, aging, and sexual orientation or race or gender, as Sherry mentioned in her question as well. Does anyone want to comment on addressing that in a way that's integrated?
So you bring up something that's important, and the first comment actually touches on it too, is that you have to start from a service provision level, and that doesn't have to be an ASO like my own, but it can be, you know, a community-based clinic as well. You have to ask, because it's not, there's no formula yet. And really, these cluster of programs and these clusters of clinical problems that we're facing, they're new, and we're in uncharted terrain. And so you asked specifically about gay men, and so one of the things that, you know, we did was we asked, and the importance of doing that is reflected in the answers that were incredibly surprising. A lot of them had to do with sexual health. A lot of them had to do with leading, you know, fulfilled dating lives. And these are members who, you know, can be in their 60s, can be more than that. And so the key is to ask. The first question I take to heart, who asked about, you know, women's programming. Or said that she didn't find herself reflected in it. So when we asked the women at ACCM, the requirements about access to care were vastly different than the men. It was much more based on social support and stigma. And so my short answer, or my long answer to a very easy, short question rather, is just ask. Membership surveys are never more important than right now in terms of HIV and aging.
Thanks, Matthew. Okay, thank you everyone for sticking it out. And I think the AGM is coming up in a few minutes for CAHR, but otherwise it's time for your evening to begin. Thanks so much. Thank you.